The Yardbirds, Cream, Blind Faith. These landmark groups share only two things in common. The first is Eric Clapton. The second is the sound of Eric's Gibson ES-335. Bought new by Eric in 1964 and cherished by him for 40 years, this musical legacy and decades-long love affair is a testament to the versatility and longevity of both the artist and his instrument. On June 24, 2004, Clapton's historic 335 was auctioned at Christie's New York to benefit Eric's Crossroads Center charity. The price? $847,000. The buyer? Guitar Center. For over a year, Eric Clapton, Gibson, and Guitar Center have worked closely together to offer a limited edition recreation of this iconic instrument. This is our story.
So, Pat Foley, you're Director of Special Projects at Gibson. Please tell us how the guitar came to fruition.
In the case of this, the Eric Clapton guitar, it was an idea that I had brought to the custom shop of doing an Eric Clapton signature guitar based on one of two guitars, either the SG or the 335. The 335 seemed to be the way to go, especially considering the auction of the guitar coming up, and actually it was Eric's choice. Eric felt more comfortable doing a reproduction of the 335, I think mainly because the guitar still exists and it's something that that he had used up until very recently.
What is the history of the instrument?
Well, this guitar actually is Eric Clapton's, I believe, his first new guitar he purchased in 64. And he's had it since then. I think it went through the Yardbirds, went through Cream, Blind Faith, and until he sold it to us being the second owners, yeah. This has been his main guitar, really.
Now, the auction must have been quite an exciting event for you, since I gather that you were the guys who actually attended it and did the bidding. Can you tell us a little bit about the auction process at Christie's?
Well, it was very exciting. There was a lot of Clapton fans, a lot of supporters of the Crossroads Foundation there. It was presented very well by Christie's and Eric. And we had gone in, we had talked to the powers to be at Guitar Center, and we specifically wanted this guitar, very interested in this guitar. We think it's one of the most used and most notable guitars in rock and roll. And of course the bidding got really intense. After the half million point, it settled down a little bit, and we were really concerned that someone else would get the guitar. However, there was a slight pause before the hammer came down and we actually took possession of it, and we really couldn't believe that we actually were able to get the winning bid on the guitar. And we were very excited, and Lee Dixon, Eric's tech, came down and congratulated us, and I know that this guitar meant a lot to Eric and to Lee, and it was, I think, the fact that Eric gave this guitar up in such a way that he did to support his foundation, Crossroads, that we just cherished that moment, and we still do.
The case itself, it's quite a piece of history on its own.
Quite. It kind of gives you chills just to see it, doesn't it?
Yeah, it really does. What particular challenges do you think are going to face Guitar Center and Gibson in the replication of the guitar?
Well, each guitar is unique because of the size of the neck, the way the neck was shaped. This particular guitar has a very eloquent feel to it. And I think that they're going to be able to capture that. That's going to be one of the important key elements to capturing this guitar and nailing it is the neck profile, the feel of the neck, and so on. There's a lot of other appointments on the guitar that they're going to have to do as well.
Well, sure, as far as the Grover tuners that aren't original, obviously the Hare Krishna decal on the top, all your little historic little nicks and grooves in the body and so on. But, you know, luckily we have Gibson that's making this guitar. And since they made it in the first place back in 1964, and they pretty much make them the same way that they did back then, there's a real good chance it's going to come out to be a great replica.
I think the guys at the Gibson Custom Shop are excited about this guitar and excited about duplicating this guitar. They know how significant it is in music history. And so I'm very confident that it's going to be a great guitar that anyone that plays guitar would like to have.
The guitar is particularly famous as the guitar that Eric used to play the Crossroads solo. Could you play that riff for us now? This is Edwin Wilson, the historic program manager at Gibson Custom Shop. So Edwin, now you're holding the XR Eric Clapton 335 for the first time. What's the plan here to recreate the instrument?
Well, typically, whenever we do reissues or we recreate an instrument, we sort of start at the top and we sort of go down, figure out what processes that we need to do in order to be able to most accurately recreate certain real pivotal parts of the instrument. There's so many things on old guitars, so many details to try to capture, and especially just besides the old guitar factor, there's all the little nuances that the artist or the individual that owned the instrument ended up putting into it, all the little marks and things like that. So we have to pay a lot of attention to the wear detail and things like that on these instruments also. So we'll just start at the top, we'll start at the peg head face and the veneer. We'll look at the checking patterns on that. We'll look at the logo placement on it for the Holly and the Gibson. We'll look at the size and the dimensions and all the little wear patterns and stuff along the top. We'll pay particular attention to the stamp on the back and the machine heads, the wear on that. Another real big thing with older guitars, but especially with this guitar that makes this guitar so special to Eric, is actually the profile and the shape of the neck. So what we'll probably do is we'll actually do a mold of the back of the neck, as well as we will put it on a machine that we have and we'll do an actual laser scan of the back of the neck so that when we get ready to manufacture it, we'll have real exact measurements to follow, real exact measurements to go by. We'll pay attention to the heel shape, the cutaway shape, the color, all the aging and stuff, and all the little attention to details of the hardware and things like that. What you're actually looking at now is the serial number on the Eric Clapton 335, and you can see that it's 67473.
Yep.
And what we have next to it here is a copy out of Gibson's original shipping ledger, where you can see 67473 ES335,
TDC that was shipped on 5/20/1964. So this is the piece of paper to verify the shipping date for this particular instrument.
And he bought the guitar brand new, didn't he?
Yeah, he did.
Is that an ABR1 bridge?
No, this is actually the third generation style ABR1 bridge. It's the first one's said ABR1 on it. This is upside down. Here we go. And by this point, Gibson had patented it. And you can see on the bottom it says Gibson, and then it's got the patent number on the bottom. So this is actually a tooling mark from the vendor that actually makes the bridges, or made the bridges at that time frame. It's his stamp.
So what do you make of the tailpiece then, Edwin?
Well, the tailpiece is original, and one of the ways that you can tell is, first of all, it's aluminum. It's real light tailpiece, and second of all, it's got this real dominant tooling line that's the brake line from the mold on the bottom of the tailpiece. And when the actual aluminum is poured into the mold and it's pressed, then this is the line on the mold where all the excess escapes out of the mold, and where the mold doesn't close together properly all the way, then it forces this line to be real dominant on the bottom of the tailpiece. And that's just typical of these tailpieces, you know, from the 50s to 60s.
And we're going to be able to replicate that accurately?
Yes, yes. The current tailpieces that we make are aluminum tailpieces. That's one of the specs, is that it has that dominant line in the bottom of it.
Good. What's the plan now?
The plan is we're going to just unscrew the pickups, pull them out of the guitar. We're going to take a look inside the control cab, inside the pickup routes. We're going to see if the pickups have been worked on or replaced, or maybe covers taken off or anything like that. A lot of times that stuff happens. Some of these screws are a little bit tight, so we'll take the easy ones first. Okay, lift this out. We're going to check it out. It is definitely a patent number pickup. Cover could have been off. Doesn't ever really look like it was soldered on there real good. Definitely loose on this side. And definitely loose on this side. Which, maybe the cover being loose there, really the lack of solder on the back here, yeah, there's some file marks. I think somebody at some point might have done something to check the pickups. Something which would maybe explain a little bit of the wear and stuff right on the edge right there. But the pickups are definitely correct for the guitar. That cover's coming up just a little bit.
Anything notable about the cavity?
The cavity just looks normal. It looks really nice. Typically, all the way through the mid-60s, the control cavities on the bodies were just solid. And what they did is they drilled this nice little quarter-inch access hole so that the wires could feed into the control cavity so that they could wire it up. And then later on, what they ended up doing is they ended up doing a cutout back here so that they could feed the control assemblies through. But it looks real typical. There's a little bit of a faux pas here on the route right there that you can notice. Probably slipped on the tool when it was being machined.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see how real nice and smooth that this route is over here.
All right.
And then you can see this little divot on this one, about the size of the cutter that they would have used. So maybe the router fixture jumped a little bit with them or something.
Where you've removed the bridge and tailpiece, you can see the variation in color.
Yeah, you can definitely see the variation in color. You see the variation in color right along there?
Yep.
And then how much lighter it is back there. And the same thing over here. You also see quite a few years of dirt and
Well, don't snatch it.
Build up and stuff right there.
White powder.
I'm going to put the pickup back in.
You did not. Got a lot of strange looking dust under it.
And take the pick guard off. You can definitely see the color under there. I'm going to take the front pickup out here and see what it looks like inside there. All right. Yeah, the front pickup looks good. The front pickup is a patent number pickup. Looks
solder.
Normal. Solder looks good. Had never been unsoldered. It's definitely original. Front pickup route looks really good. Looks real normal. The one thing that's sort of unique about the front pickup is the fact that they've got the actual mounting ring on there backwards. And they did that on a lot of BS guitars to try to get the pickup to actually sit in the guitar to where it's more parallel with the strings, because the pressing of the top of the body actually shoots down. And so they would put it to where the high side of the ring is to the front of the neck and the low side is to the back, so that it'll sort of level the pick out more, which is not the norm. It's a little bit unusual, but not too unusual.
It's not the norm, but that's the way this is.
You'll see a lot of arch tops that are like that. What you can see right here is a little bit of the color variation from where the pick guard is. I'm just going to sort of follow along. Comes down like this, then it comes back around like this up to here, and then you can see right here there's a little bit of a line there, and you might not be able to see it real good, but there's a definite change in color right here, because the pick guards, it doesn't fit on the guitar in between the pickups real tight. You see it has a space here, and
right,
you see that space.
Absolutely.
Also in the color of the guitar.
So what's all this?
This is probably just dirt and whatever else from all the time Eric playing it and stuff. There's a lot of dirt around the pickups and stuff. At this point, I think what we'll do is we'll carry it back to our Como, our CNC machine, and we're going to digitize the neck.
Anomalies reflecting off of the lacquer. If it was a dull surface, none of that would be apparent. It's spikes from the camera and the laser beam.
I see.
And in this sculpturing program, we can get rid of all of the basically the 3D noise.
Okay, let's do that. There you go.
Thank you.
You're measuring all the frets.
I'm going to take, just to make sure that they're all, I mean, those three are about as much the same as you could possibly be. So I think it's safe to say.
You're checking for consistency then?
Yeah, I'm checking to make sure that my measurement is consistent with all of them, just to make sure that when we do this, we get the right width fret wire to start with and everything. That's amazing.
That's amazing, Daddy.
And it's at 1 inch, perfect. It's pretty wild.
How's it looking?
It's about 040 tall, but you can see where when it was dressed out at some point, that it was dressed out to where things still see some razor scratches in it. Just right along the edge there. These are about 5/1000ths shorter than up here, so the fret tapers up, which makes sense.
Okay, so this is how we're gonna replicate the Hare Krishna label. The purpose of tracing around the perimeter is to do what, Edwin?
It's just for reference. Make sure that we're accurate on our body, on our perimeter shape for this model. Mostly with the horns. Perfect.
Indeed.
So the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to go out and we're going to check our color sample and make sure that it's coming along well.
That's great.
That's great.
got it. Thank you.
Okay.
So do you keep that as a sample for the whole run?
We'll keep that as our sample for the whole run. It'll be a constant reference for us. Yeah, this is the color sample for the Eric Clapton model.
No, I'm sorry, the name of our artist.
This is Mickey McGuire.
Mickey McGuire, hi.
Sorry, good to meet you. Okay.
Take care.
Thanks.
Okay, what are we going to do, Edwin?
We're going to mix up the molding stuff. We're going to pour it in the mold. We're going to put the guitar in the mold. We're going to hold it down. It takes it about 90 seconds to start to set up. We're going to hold it in there for 5 minutes to make sure that we get a good mold of it. Then we'll pull the guitar out. We'll be done.
And the purpose of this exercise is?
The purpose of this exercise is to make a negative of the back of the neck. And then what we will do once we have a negative is we'll get some the opposite of the molding paste, and we'll pour it in and we'll make a positive. And then we'll have a real good profile of the neck shape.
Great.
On your feet.
And they go wild.
Oh. We'll leave that like that. I'll put the ends on. Then we'll put the second part in there after it's set up for 24 hours or so. And we'll make a positive.
Great. Can we see if there's any residue on the back of the guitar?
Sure.
Perfect. Well done.
This edge actually comes up about a quarter of an inch below the surface. So this is pretty deep. This is actually about that thick at the base. So it's got the profile in it, and it's actually got some depth to it. So once that comes out, you'll see a real clear image of how sort of round or elliptical the neck is.
Okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to carry the guitar out into the custom shop, and we're going to visit the different stations, and we're going to look at where the bodies are going to be made. We'll look at some bodies that we started on, and we're going to see where the necks are going to be shaped and probably do a sample neck.
Great.
So, let's go. We're at the neck rolling station right now, and this is Chris Seeger. Chris rolls all the necks at the custom shop. And whenever I have special projects or something, he's the man that I've come to. He's going to be the guy that I'm going to give this guitar to and get him to do a copy of the neck. He's going to roll it in, and we're just going to watch him. We're going to watch him go through the process and see how he does it, because he'll be doing all the necks on these guitars.
Good, thank you.
First thing I have to do right now is put a little taper on the head stuff, and then I'll get the feeling out this neck and get through all this out, okay? Feel this neck and go back and forth to check my work. I mean, that's basically how we do it on everything. Alright, so I'm gonna start rolling it now.
what we just saw is a guy, Jonathan McClanahan, that's going to be building all of the 335 bodies for this particular model. And you just saw him construct the rims, glue the rims together. And that's one of the first processes.
And what's the next process?
The next process after this is done is once these are glued together like this, then the carving will get glued in. And you can see this guy's name is Phil Ashworth. Phil's been here for a long time. How long have you been here, Phil?
20 years.
Phil's been here for 20 years. He's one of the best builders that Gibson's ever had. And he's gluing the carving in right now. He's using the spring clamps to hold it in. And the next process on the 335 will be the same as on this one, which is an L4 mahogany rim. So this is Doug Culverson. He's the guy that's in charge of our arch tops and all the ES stuff that we make here in the custom shop. And he's gonna explain really what's next after the rims are assembled as far as the body construction goes and walk you through that.
Yeah, basically what's gonna happen, the same thing that Phil's doing over there on the L4 body. You're gonna put the rim lining in and then we'll surface the rim down. On the Eric Clapton model, you're not gonna have this cut out like this. This is actually an Alvin Lee model, but his had just a straight block, no cutout, so all the controls go through the F-holes. But basically, we get all the curving on both sides, the rim, we'll run it through the sander to get both sides flat, and then we'll glue a top and a back on. And the top and back both have a brace like this on them. It's called a contour brace. The reason it's got the slots in there so that the brace can actually flex to the shape of the top. And then once you put that on, you have to surface the brace down flat, so then when it goes on the guitar on the block, it's like that. And the contour braces are all made out of like a A-grade spruce, which is real nice grade of spruce. Try not to kill any of the sound. So.
That'll happen is we wrap it for the binding, which is where we route the edge of the guitar so that we can put the binding onto it. This is Butch Wallace. He's one of the best people here in the custom shop also. He's been here for 27 years. So you notice most of the guys that are going to be working on this are guys that have been around for a long time, have a whole lot of experience. And these are typically all the guys that they work on all the stuff, but we sort of pick them out to really work on the special stuff for us. Make sure that we get stuff really right the first time. So what we'll do is we'll watch Butch, watch him route for the binding on this. Our binder here, he's our lead binder here, and what we did is this morning we started binding the bodies, and we've got the first side bound, and it takes about 4 hours once they get the binding on there and everything before they can pull it off and they can do the other side. Gibson still uses the hand roping style with the nylon rope, and what we're going to do is we're going to watch him bind the second side now. you glue a neck in.
Some of the things that we'll go over is just some of the points that when we reproduce this guitar, we're going to try to duplicate. And there's a few notable features about this guitar. It's actually got a gold washer and a nickel 3/8 hex nut on the output jack, where someone's changed the washer out on that. And then some of the other just sort of standard features. We'll make sure that it has the black top hat knobs on it with the dial pointers and the white toggle switch cap on it. The lightweight aluminum stop bar tail piece. And one of the things that was real typical of 60s 335s is the chrome hardware, mid-60s chrome hardware with plastic saddles in it. It'll have a short pick guard on it with sort of a wide bevel on the edge. One of the other unique features about this guitar is the fact that the closed nut on the outside of the pick guard rod is actually broken off and missing. So we'll make sure that ours will match that also. The pick guard actually has a gap in between the rear pickup ring and the pick guard itself. So we'll make sure to get that spacing the same on that and copy that. And like all of the ES guitars that we do out of the custom shop, we'll make sure that it gets the orange label inside the top F-hole. Can't really see real good. But as you saw earlier, we already did our color sample so that we matched the top and the back of the neck and everything on the color sample. We'll make sure that we do the small block inlays, which is a 60s thing. We'll do the wide white band, flat, custom inlay truss rod cover. And we'll make sure that we change the machine heads out. The original machine heads would have been Clusons with the green plastic buttons on them. But we'll make sure that we put the gold Grovers on there. And we'll age them some to take some of the patina off. And then on the back of the guitar, one of the things that we'll do is it has a couple of character marks in the back of the body. This is one of the character marks, and then the paint actually missing there. You actually see the stain that's originally applied to the maple. And then it's got a little gash in it right here where it's actually lifted part of the veneer. And then as you see the neck, you notice that the neck is much darker than the back, and it's the finishing process and the color that they use and the fact that it's mahogany and not maple. And you'll notice that the heel is sort of dark starting at this point all the way up, and it's a little bit lighter in the middle there, mostly from wear. And then it gets a little bit dark again about the waist right there, the neck, and then goes all the way to the end of the headstock. It's a little bit darker. You also notice the hair cushion sticker on the back.
We're going to replicate the sticker as well?
We're working on it.
Thank you.
Here we are a couple months later. Eric Clapton has received a prototype. He signed off on a prototype. So we basically got to go on this thing. And what we're going to do now is, this is some of the first ones right here. We're going to take you through the final stages of this thing. We'll show you the buffing. We'll show you the neck and the fingerboard prep on it. We'll show you the final assembly on it.
Hi, I'm Frank Johns, supervisor of electronics department at Gibson. We're about to show you how we wind the custom shop pickups for the Eric Clapton models. slug press where we press the slugs into each coil. Each coil will have a slug side and a screw side. Okay. Now we're about to show the wax potting process. We'll drop the pickups into the basket, into the hot wax at 150 degrees, and let them sit until all the air bubbles has come to the surface. Starting to come out of the covers. It'll take 5, 6, 8 minutes or so to get all the air out of the cover, out of the pickup, and we can ensure it won't be microphonic at that point.
Okay, what we're gonna do now is we're gonna watch the buffing process on these. He's actually already started buffing it and done the first part. Now he's gonna do the middle stage and then the final cleanup. This is Philip Bass. He's been here a couple of years and he's our lead buffer over here. Does a great job on everything. Chris is part of our little engineering, working on these special guitars team, and Chris is going to work on the fingerboards on these, on all the Claptons so far. He's fret leveled all of them. He's the guy responsible for playing. Finishes them out, dresses them out, does one of the nicest jobs dressing out fingerboards that I've ever seen. Chris has been here for 3 years, and he's gonna dress out one of the next now and show you how it's done.
All right. First thing I'm going to do is take off the lacquer, which I've already done most of on this guitar. I've left a little here. When we do the original level, there is some rounding. The initial bevel is rounded, but there's a buildup of lacquer that we then have to sand down. And then in the actual polishing of the frets, which is successively using finer grades of sandpaper, we'll roll along the edge a little bit to try and blend that, soften that line between the lacquer and the binding.
How much time do you spend dressing the frets in this sort of operation?
Oh, I kind of don't know. I lose track of time.
Thank you.
Where we're at right now is the final assembly process of the guitars, and this is Mitch Truttle. Mitch has been with Gibson for 15 years. He's done about everything that you can do for the company, and he's without a doubt one of the best assemblers that has ever worked at this place.
and Mitch is working with me on assembling these guitars. So we've got this one partially assembled already. We sort of started, and we're going to finish it out now. But where we're going to start is we're going to start with putting the serial number into the front pickup cavity. So the serial number that's in the front pickup cavity will correspond with the serial number that is on the label, which is actually the Gibson and the Guitar Center serial number that'll be followed. So,
and since this is the first one we're going to be building, this will be 001. Finishing touch to the Eric Clapton model is the Hare Krishna stamp.
Took the prototype to England, presumably to show to Clapton. What were the comments upon seeing it?
The final prototype, which he got just a matter of weeks ago, in the run up to the Cream shows, he actually saw the first prototype. And his comment, and this is Lee Dixon who passed this on to me, was that when Eric walked in the studio and saw the guitar, he said, "Oh, you've got the original guitar back. How'd you do that?" Right? Lee got on the phone to me immediately and said, "We've done it. We've pulled it off. Because if we could fool Eric, then I think we're pretty close." And again, the case has been a big hit. Everybody loved the fact that we actually reproduced all the markings on the case, the interior lining. So it's been just a pleasurable experience, I think, for everybody. And it's going to raise a lot of money for Eric's charity, mm-hmm. and I think it reflects well on both Gibson and Guitar Center, and by all means on Eric Clapton. I think that he's proud of what we've done. I like to think so, anyway.
I'm sure. Well, on behalf of musicians everywhere, especially those who are going to be fortunate enough to own this guitar and to play it, we thank you.
Oh, thank you very much.
We'll be right back.
Eric Clapton, please, the vocal.